Our success in the challenges of life is often gauged against expectations drawn on a scale of attained age. At conception, we begin the process of aging. Settling into any stage, we begin to sense changing. We all have heard the admonition, act your age. Then time passage is often forcing us to turn the page. Dealing with getting older can take so much of our time, particularly as teens, but also as seniors and even in prime. On a recent podcast, I requested written submissions. Responses were asked to deal with specific questions. Many respondents sent tones on relevant subjects. Two in particular displayed merit in many respects. Colleen brings an unusual perspective to motherhood. Listening to her journey helps to make it understood.
My sister and I were separated by 7 years, so I was well positioned to review the life stages that I had navigated earlier. Our many character differences were exceeded only by the similarities of our experiences. Where I tended to be shy and quiet, she could be brash and impetuous. I especially loved her willingness to experiment, where I was satisfied to observe from the shadows. Situations that I had resolved with negotiation and compromise would only result in confrontation for Diane. The availability of two working and driven parents often rendered me as the first level of mediation for Diane in her sometimes boisterous existence. We were both very athletic, but where I played the outfield, she was a pitcher. Where I was a defender, she played reckless forward in soccer. It was a great source of pride for me that she saw me as a role model and tended to participate in sports and other activities that I had initially enjoyed. The difference was that she was had always exceeded my levels of performance. In nothing else was this more obvious than high school basketball, where she excelled to the point of receiving several scholarship offers. I was already establishing myself in the world of commercial art when she went off to play ball and study nursing at a Division I university. It marked the first time that I had spent an extended period of time apart and missed her even more than I would have expected. Missing Diane was mitigated when the romance of my life blossomed during her absence. John's company became a customer prospect, and our relationship grew from the long meetings that we spent formulating their requirements. His company decided to accept another proposal, but John continued to pursue me. I was almost 30 and had fallen hopelessly in love for the first time in my life. We'd been making plans for our wedding when I discovered his lifeless body at his apartment on a Sunday morning. A sudden coronary event due to a valve defect was the culprit, and it also shattered my heart. I never lost anyone so close to me, and I didn't have my sister for consolation, and she had joined the Army after achieving her nursing degree and was serving in a war zone.
With the search so long and the discovery so sweet, the loss of one's life love must have cut quite deep.
I immersed myself in my work and, together with my partner Phyllis, started a graphic design company. When Diane returned from her last deployment, she was accompanied by her new husband and fellow medical professional, Dr. Bill French, and was also pregnant with their first child. I always found time to enjoy the company of Diane's growing brood. Through school events, sports, holiday celebrations, and even some vacations, I had the joy of experiencing her family as it expanded to 3, 2 girls, then a boy. I had become Auntie C. Of course, no one was prepared for the car accident that occurred the week before Christmas, 2 days after my 43rd birthday. Diane and Bill were returning from a shopping trip in the middle of a snowstorm. They were T-boned in an intersection by a heavy SUV traveling well beyond a reasonable speed for the conditions. Driving on the impact side, Diane was killed immediately, and Bill received crippling and life-threatening injuries. My godchildren, aged 13, 11, and 9, were left with no mother and a father who was facing months of rehabilitation. Given my parents' age and diminished health, I was the only family member capable of providing direct assistance. I moved into the guest room of their house and began the process of becoming a second-hand mother.
Another sudden loss of a very close loved one, resulting dark feelings, could blot out the sun.
I quickly realized that I had to sublimate my own grief over losing my sister and best friend in order to minister to three victims who had suffered an even greater loss. Katie, the oldest, was just entering puberty, which compounded her issues. She so resembled her mother in looks and personality that I would sometimes accidentally call her Diane, which would bring us both to tears. The other two presented more mysteries for me to face, but my earlier experience in observing my sister served me well in attempting to understand and help them cope with their grief and daily lives. The first summer after the accident, my business partner, Phyllis, and I organized a mountain hiking expedition with the kids. The mountain air, the wonderful scenery, and the exercise seemed to be very therapeutic prior to beginning a new school year.
Children by nature are truly wondrous beings. They need full attention and mess with your things.
That sounds good.
Bill's recovery was long and arduous, as he had suffered memory loss, most of which was recovered, along with serious damage to both legs and his right arm. Fortunately, there was no permanent damage to his spine, and he would eventually become fully ambulatory. He was able to come home after about 15 months. Soon afterwards, his recovery allowed him to resume his job as an emergency room physician. I returned to my apartment about a month after Bill came back. I was a little surprised by how much I missed the constant proximity to the children, but I gradually adapted to a more solitary life. However, I no longer held the comfortable position of Auntie C. I now received frequent phone calls and visits and regularly scheduled a Sunday dinner. One or two of the children would also accompany me on my periodic hiking trips. I never attempted to replace Diane in their lives, but I did strive to provide some of the discipline and support that children crave from their mother. What they gave to me was immeasurable. I got a glimpse into parenthood and what it means to have the responsibility to provide security for and direction to another life. Such selfless activity was shockingly new to me, and in a relatively short period after losing my sister, I rapidly matured and dramatically aged.
No other undertaking is as sobering as parenting. For starters, I equals one is no longer the thing. Kids suck up your energy and then want to play, keep you up half the night, and then savage the day. They continuously offer noise, tears, puke, and poo for the most rewarding activity that you'll ever do.
For now I need your hidden love. I'm cold as a new razor blade. You left when I told you I was curious. I never said that I was brave. Oh, so long, Marianne. It's time that we began to laugh and cry and cry and laugh.